Let's continue with our discussion of space and place, turning to the American home and suburbs. In the past, a house was thought of as a repository of a family's history, a place where family heirlooms and other memories were displayed. Today, houses are often seen as financial investments, the purchase of a lifestyle with all the modern conveniences of affluent suburban life, such as security and maintenance services, minus the crime and the dirt. Remember the saying, fences make good neighbors? Fences serve as a buffer zone between public and private space. But as the poet Robert Frost asks, what was I walling in and walling out? In other words, fences divide us from people. The home came to be regarded as a sanctuary and identified as women's space, but the porch was a symbol of women's resourcefulness in overcoming the isolation they were experiencing. Porches were betwixt and between the private inside of the house in the public arena dominated by men. In the past, front porches also served as gendered buffer zones between the public and the domestic sphere. They faced the street and thus also served as social spaces where friends, neighbors, and passers-by would interact. The title here, Patio Man and the Sprawl People, is taken from a satirical 2002 column by David Brooks. But the point I want to make is that many newer homes face backwards toward the private space of the backyard patio. In 19th and early 20th century British estates, two almost entirely separate groups of people occupied the same house. Social differences were marked by spatial arrangements. Here we see the house used in the filming of Robert Altman's 2001 film, Gosforth Park. In these scenes from Gosforth Park, we see the wealthy class upstairs at a dinner party and the servants downstairs in the kitchen preparing a meal. Life at home in the 21st century explores social history, consumerism, contemporary culture, the meaning of material culture, domestic architecture, household ethno-archaeology, and daily home life in suburban households. It's based on a 10-year study of 32 ordinary Californian middle-class families. As these photographs suggest, one of the themes has to do with how much we have and how cluttered our homes are in the age of consumption. In some ways, we're almost oppressed by our stuff. The 2000 book Suburban Nation by Andres Dwani and his co-authors made me think differently about how we have culturally redefined urban and suburban spaces. In the second half of the 20th century, suburbs came to be the dominant desired middle-class living space in the United States. This led to very different spatial organization, experiences, and meanings from rural and urban life. Dwani and his co-authors are highly critical of suburban sprawl, which they see as economically and environmentally wasteful and socially isolating, in part because we spend so much time behind the wheel in traffic. I should note that some of my students have told me that they enjoy driving and see it as personal time in their busy lives. The authors of Suburban Nation identify five chief components of sprawl. First, they cite housing subdivisions, also called clusters or pods. Subdivisions are often built according to price points, that is, how much individual houses cost in the subdivisions, say from the 190,000s or from the 300,000s. A second feature of sprawl is shopping centers, also called strip centers, shopping malls, in big box retail. Often, unlike mixed residential business, commercial neighbors in traditional cities, shopping centers are often exclusively for shopping. Although some of the new shopping malls are including high-end apartments, condos, and hotels. Here we see the separation of residential and commercial space at Bridgewater Falls near where I live. Could you imagine living in an apartment upstairs from Target? My students who live in the subdivision across the street insist that they used to ride their bikes to the center, but as I see it, this is a landscape dominated by automobiles and unfriendly to pedestrians. A third suburban space is the office park. These spaces are often exclusively for work. The fourth component of suburbia is public projects, the town halls, churches, schools, and other places where people gather for communication and culture. In traditional neighborhoods, these buildings often serve as neighborhood focal points, but in suburbia, they are often separate from other spaces and subdivisions. Because pedestrian access is usually non-existent, and because the dispersion of surrounding homes often makes school buses impractical, schools in the new suburbs are often designed based on the assumption of massive automotive transportation. The fifth and final component is roadways. Miles of pavement are necessary to connect the other four disassociated components. Since each piece of suburbia serves only one type of activity, and since daily life involves a wide variety of activities, the residents of suburbia spend an unprecedented amount of time and money moving from one place to the next. Since most of this motion takes place in singly occupied automobiles, even a sparsely populated area can generate the traffic of a much larger traditional town. Let me end this presentation with just a few different kinds of spaces and places. Delaney refers to invisible spaces, including hospitals, nursing homes, mental institutions, prisons, and cemeteries, as places for the ill, the criminal, the dying, the dead, and anything else we do not like to contemplate. All cemeteries serve the same essential purpose, to separate the dead from the living, while preserving the connection of the living, of the dead rather, to the living. Finally, Delaney mentions non-spaces, such as cyberspace. If cyberspace is more metaphorical than material, does it make sense to include it in this discussion of space and place? The answer, according to Delaney, is yes, because like physical space, it is the foundation of multiple social fields and processes, and because it profoundly transforms our experience of physical space and its limitations. How much time do you spend in cyberspace? Well, maybe it's unfair to ask this question in an online course. As the saying goes, we've covered a lot of ground here, but have only hinted at some of the ways we live in, traverse, experience, conceptualize, and imagine the diverse cultural spaces of our world. In closing, I'd like to return to an idea I raised at the beginning of this presentation. Think about the diverse spaces you move through as you go about your day. Home, school, work, friends' places, your car, streets, roads, highways, stores, church, bars and restaurants, etc. Where do you go and where don't you go? What are the meanings of these various spaces? In other words, how do you convert them into places? What does this say about you and us culturally?